This is a production of Cornell University.
I hope here to lightly touch on a number of areas where animals and soils interact. This is not a comprehensive thing that has to go from beginning to end. If there's areas that are of interest, then stop the whole thing. We can talk about it. This, what I think seminars ought to be more interactive than they usually are. But I will throw some things out, some ideas, for a few minutes to kind of get the juices rolling. My background in soil science, I've always liked standing on soil. I wash a lot out of the clothes. I took soil science from Dr. Munns and Dilwich at UC Davis years and years ago in Hoagland Hall, named after the man who had a solution. And it was fun. Dilwich, interesting, Dr. Dilwich's twin was a professor of microbiology here at the same time. That was a long time ago. We also learned about soils and range management and pasture management, that sort of thing, courses. And as I'll mention here, I've run into working with soils off and on over the years, often brought home to me by just dumb mistakes I made. And those are the lessons you learn, you remember the best and most important to pass along. To make things relevant, I always like to look in the paper, see if there's any stories out there related to, in this case, to plant nutrition or animals or soils. And I wasn't disappointed this week. There was an incident further up the lake where a large dairy which stores a lot of manure in the winter. They're trying to get away from spreading manure on snow and then having it all wash away into the creeks in the spring. But it's a very large dairy. It got bigger. And so they built a second storage and containment unit, and they transfer to the first one, and then there's some kind of structure that transfers to the second, which failed. They had to fall back on spreading on the snow, which is not a great way to manage nutrients, but usually, after a few months on the snow, some of the nutrients work down to the soil surface, and then it rained, and it got warm, and it all ran away from them and wound up in Cayuga Lake. It's unfortunate. I mean, these aren't clowns. These are people who are making conscientious effort to do nutrient management, but have come up against what, as you get bigger and more concentrated animals, it becomes a very difficult problem to address it at any cost. We used to worry about algal blooms in Lake Erie. They cleared up for a while, but in the last 5 years or so, they've popped back up. Limiting nutrients from Ohio farms and probably some other farms upstream as well, Indiana and so on, made its way, and it's restarted the eutrophication issues that you have out there in the lake. I think most of you are familiar with that concept, but it's if an oversupply of some limiting nutrient, sometimes it's nitrogen, sometimes it's phosphorus. Whatever's limiting the growth of algae in a body of water will allow algae to grow faster than and more fully than otherwise, which is nasty enough. But some of these algae are also release toxins. Along the southeast coast, we've had cases with manure spills that have resulted in increases in organisms that release toxic materials that affect the life there. And nobody lives forever, including algae. And when they die and decay, they deplete the oxygen, which makes the fish sad, because they ask, they call their gills for oxygen, and all they get is a busy signal, and then they die. So it's something to look out. One of the disturbing, this also is happening in China as well, but in California, after years and years, this is specifically, these reports are Salinas Valley, Tulare Basin, which looks like it's in the San Joaquin Valley if you look at the map, but it's kind of over a rise, and also the San Joaquin Valley proper, and there are other places in California as well. Years and years of nutrient management or mismanagement, a lot of these soils are very light. they have a lot of sand in them. And with the warm weather and the irrigation and the small amount of organic matter to begin with, which disappears pretty quickly, farming in some of the soils in California is more like hydroponics. You're putting in, you know, the amendments and it goes. And this has really come back to haunt people in that area. And it looks like these nitrate problems in the groundwater and the aquifers are going to worsen in several decades, no matter what we do, because some of the nitrates hitting the water supply, the drinking water supply now, started on their way down there 10 or 20 years ago. And so, yeah, we need to do something, but it's quite an issue. Something that other regions would do well to get ahead of. The agricultural fertilizers and animal waste, and a lot of those agricultural fertilizers are going to grow crops, which are used for animals as well. There's other sources that can be locally relevant. For example, we have processing plants that process massive amounts of milk. They have a lot of whey, and what do you do with the whey? You go put it on land. Well, if you put on enough land, then it can be incorporated back properly, and it's all fine. But a number of years ago, about 10 years ago, they found some plants that were dumping their entire whey stream on, you know, like 8 acres, and that didn't work out too well. So there's other things that can be locally important. It's difficult to do remediation once all this stuff is in the groundwater. One thing that they suggested is just pump that wonderful water, call it fertigation, and don't apply any nitrogen except with the water. So at least it's not out of the soil, but at least it's circulating back near the top. These are issues that we'll have to solve, and very often the people solving them may not be the ones that put the nutrients there. There's all sorts of other things that they suggest doing. Now, in terms of sustainability, you've probably heard all of this. If I use the term through here, I might be using it in any of three different ways. One is the one that came up through many committees in the 20th century, that sustainable agriculture is environmentally sound, economically feasible, socially just. Doesn't that sound like it was from a committee? But it makes sense. In each one of those, we can deconstruct. In our courses, since I'm a nutritional toxicologist, I always say the sustainable ag conserves nutrients without concentrating toxicants by procedures robust enough to withstand social and economic change. So systems of management that are setting up a sustainable system need to be useful in a number of different economic, sociological, political settings. So if you switch from democracy to fascism for a while, it shouldn't have any impact on the groundwater if you've chosen your management methods carefully. And Liberty High Bailey was much more proactive, much more activist, and much more forward-looking. He says, heck with the sustainability. His famous quote on the subject is, the productiveness of the earth must increase from generation to generation. So he's pushing it. Now, when I teach a number of courses, you know, we talk about many things the animals provide us and things we provide for them. And I'll try to stick to some most relevant to soils today. The lateral vertical transfer of nutrients is incredibly important. I know there's a number of people in the department that have worked on that over the years, in terms of nutrients being moved vertically. They provide draft transport for distribution of nutrients. Capital accumulation, in case you've got a soil-related project, the banks aren't usually worth much, but you can go sell some animals. Conversion of human and edible resources. Most of the land with soil that we use for our agricultural systems are not tilled, they're grazed. And more than half the Earth's land surface, at one time or another, gets used that way. And it's a great alternative to composting. We'll talk about that a little bit. And there's a few other things here we could talk about if you're interested. In terms of lateral vertical transfer of nutrients, animals graze and browse a lot more area than can be cultivated. Some of the comparisons you may have read over the year, what's better, confinement animal or grazing animal? Well, it depends on how you do it, of course, so these are kind of silly exercises. But very often, there's an implicit assumption underlying the comparisons that, you know, the grazing and the grazing of row crops that are going to the animals are on the same land. And this isn't true. If you were to do that comparison only on steep hillsides or in rocky areas, places poorly drained, you know, there'd be no comparison because there'd be no corn or soybeans up there. Or if you tried it, it would, you know, wreck the resource. So that's one of the advantages, and certainly that's done. Also, as a number of you probably learned in soil science classes, I only took the one and they didn't mention it, but the browse and perennial forage species, even some of the herbaceous species, especially if it's been established for years and years and years and years, they have deep and extensive root systems, very dense, very deep. In this area, we don't think of Ithaca as a tropical area. That's good because it's not. But if you go out there in the woods and so on, or places that have been cleared, you know, a lot of the soils are fairly well developed near the surface. They certainly don't have the full complement of cations and useful trace minerals that the parent rock did, or you find in other systems. And so this can be handy here, and certainly for millennia, trees were bringing up nutrients from underground and dropping them in the ground. And early farmers here used a lot of that up. But this broad range of nutrients can be brought up. Animals will browse on either woody plants, they have very deep roots and have been there a long time, or on pastures, or long tap-rooted leguminous species, all kinds of things. And they can actually deliver and distribute those trace minerals to the surface. Another way is night folding, or bringing them into a boma, a kraal, or whatever you want to call it. Bring the animals in at night, collect that manure, and then you can use it locally. Some different examples I can think of this. Back in the 80s and 90s, I was involved in what they call the Small Ruminant Crisp program that did research on llamas and sheep and goats and all that sort of thing in an international setting. I think you remember the CRISP programs, and they call them the PMIL programs. These are funded by USDA and USAID, and usually involve American universities. What was my point? Oh, went to a meeting in about 1990, and they have a sociology division, and the grad students that go out and actually do the work for this program went out thinking, well, you know, if we just get rid of the animals, they wouldn't have the starvation here and there. They're in the way. They're taking resources. And some of the first questions they asked when they got to the Altiplano and different parts of Peru was, why do you raise sheep? They go, well, I raise sheep so that I can grow food. And then they go to the market, and there's people running around with little bags of sheep pellets selling to people. So even some of those famous raised bed little places where they grow potatoes and all sorts of things, those were fertilized historically by llamas and alpacas and those sorts of things. And when the Spanish wiped those out or reduced them greatly and replaced them with sheep, they continue with sheep. And so this lateral transfer, the ability to bring nutrients horizontally across land, has been part of sustaining the soils and sustaining the productivity in a lot of different areas. I think some others. You can goof that up too, but East Africa during the colonial period. Remember, this is before Haber processed nitrogen is readily available, before we had these huge, you know, globalist, you know, transfers of nutrients from continent to continent. There were some, but mostly people worked with what they had. And a lot of the people from East Africa, including colonists, would send livestock out free and wide, bring them back home, and build the soils locally with micronutrients and so on, and to make them more productive. To mistakes done and soil lessons learned. I worked in Western Kenya for a while, and we were working with dual-purpose goats. We had goats which would give milk, and their young would provide meat, and this was thought to be a great deal. Well, eventually it's discovered that the most important contribution to the whole food chain, the whole food system, was not necessarily the meat or the milk, but those are great. And, you know, they did help, and there are children alive because they got some milk from that. But the biggest contribution to the whole deal was through the manure onto the soil. Some of the soils in our area were about 4.6 pH. I always wanted to run out with a copper rod and a zinc rod and see if I could light something. You know, it was that acid. And the so there were some legumes you really weren't going to do too well with, like alfalfa. In Rift Valley, fine. Over there in Naivasha, they had a great time. We couldn't do it there. But every expert that came to talk to us said, you should be planting alfalfa. You know, all from the Americans. You know, alfalfa's every, you should plant alfalfa. The agronomist on the project finally got tired of it, and she grew a little plot of alfalfa, and it would get about that tall. We call it her alfalfa bonsai plot. And so when somebody came and says, why aren't you growing alfalfa? She could grab them by the collar, drag them over, and go, you know, like this. And, you know, it worked. It was cheap education. Well, the mistake I made there was we were doing digestion trials, we were doing a lot of feeding trials, and really wanted to know how the animals were handling and transferring nutrients and all over. And in the process of that, we had to train the animals to get on the milking stand. At first, we were using East African goats, then we had some crossbreds, and I brought a load of Togaber goats up from the coast, from an old colonial family. That's a long story. But we got them going and milking, and to train them, I didn't want to put a bunch of grain on there because it would goof up our calculations for digestibility and everything. So I got smart. I go, oh, I know why they'll, you know, train and come back. We'll just take a little pinch of trace mineral salt, put there. They love that stuff. And we did that, and they got trained, and the people who were milking milked, and they decided they would keep doing that. So we did the experiments with the manure, and for a year, it seems like the manure didn't help the crops at all. Didn't matter what we were planting. And it wasn't until we left and they quit doing the, you know, putting the mineral salt for training the animals, that all of a sudden the Kenyans who took over, good researchers, they found tremendous impact of the manure. What had happened, as you all know, is that didn't do my math too well. I mean, pinch. How much is a pinch? It added up. And so when the manure went out to the field, it had enough salt to really foul up its agronomic value. So yeah, fortunately, the Kenyans figured it out, and that was one of the greatest things that goat project provided. The milk was great, it was good in tea, meat once in a while for a party, but by streaming those nutrients, the organic matter, the micronutrients and everything through without the salt, it had a great and positive impact. Indonesia, they'll keep sheep and maybe sometimes goats. In Fiemet, you may have seen these with the bamboo or eucalypt sticks kind of in an elevated cage, and then the manure drops down and they can pick that up and they can put it where they need it. Sometimes it's dropping down into a pond where they're raising fish, so they're fertilizing the pond to grow, you know, plant material, so they're, whatever their fish are that they're eating it, can take that. And it happens in the US as well. Here, there was such an awareness on animal farms up until, you know, through the 19th century into the early 20th century of what exactly the animals needed and what they really were providing, that when they shifted from a system where they were separating the cream on the farm, making butter, you were sending out what? Carbon, hydrogen, oxygen. Nothing, virtually nothing else. The buttermilk, and the skim milk was slopped to hogs. Manure went back on the land, or was just put on the land. And when they said, "Hey, we'll buy your milk, all of it, and we're going to do stuff with it over here in this factory," a lot of farmers says, "Wait, this. Remember, this is before you could buy a lot of nitrate fertilizer. They were depending upon nitrogen from rains, maybe a little tiny bit of nitrogen fertilization." After a thunder snow, they go out and plow it down to try to keep the nitrogen. They were very, plus all the other nutrients. And they were very concerned that over time that they would lose these nutrients as milk, and that would compromise what they were doing. It's kind of the level of awareness as you develop when you don't have a lot of alternatives for fertilizing. And we'll talk about another one a little bit. In terms of draft, the animals also interact with the soil in this way. People use draft for a lot of reasons. They don't cost much in capital outlay relative to tractors, especially on smaller farms. You're using the local fuel, feed, and byproducts. You can make the equipment, make the harnesses. You've got a lump of metal or a little foundry out back. You can bang a plowshare, maresha, whatever you want to call it, into shape. And same thing as spare parts and maintenance. In contrast to tractors, which require large capital outlay. They're often made overseas if you're in some countries. The equipment, the maintenance can be expensive, the parts can be expensive, and it's that way. And I guess some of the tractor companies now are not letting you maintain your own tractors. I don't think that's become a thing in Africa yet, but it certainly has here in the US. Well, one thing with the horses is that if you've ever, how many of you have been on a farm that only used horses, you walked around the field? What does it feel like when you're walking around on the soil relative to a place that's plowed with tractors? Do you notice the difference? Softer, a little more springy. It has what, you know, it has tilth, it has loft, it has, and you know, they're converting a lot of those higher carbon compounds into higher nitrogen carbon ratio or lower carbon nitrogen ratio compounds as they defecate, and it's all good. Also, it increases the amount of acreage it's tillable relative to hand labor, and you can use the animal for a number of different purposes. So there is a interaction that we study some, but mostly in the teaching context. Transport, same thing. If you need soil amendments, if you need to get your market more than walking distance from where you are, very often animals are needed. There aren't roads to everywhere. And in a place like Ethiopia, if you visit, you're probably spending most of your time on roads or maybe dirt tracks. But that is the skin of the onion with regard to where people are, where things are grown, where animals are. A lot of it is in these countries is going by beasts of burden, both inputs in and the other out, and that's going to have an impact as well. A lot of this. I don't know if this is just for soils, but also animals represent capital accumulation. If you get ahead, and you don't need to sell the animal right away. You can keep them to a different season or a different year and sell it. So banking services historically have not been great. I guess with the cell phones now, they're coming up with new ways of doing things. But very often the bank wouldn't let small farmers in there. I saw a guy thrown out of a Barclays bank in 1982 because he just wasn't of the class that was allowed to have banking services. And so it's an alternative to that. So if you go ask them, hey, do this improvement in soils, make a composting system here, and they go, oh, okay, I'll invest in that. And they go, but they're not going to go to the bank because they wouldn't let them in, or if they went, you know, the inflation is such that sometimes a decimal point on the exchange rate is just a blur going by. They'll go to their bank of animals in many of these. And of course, the animals convert massive amounts of human and edible resources, both to food and to manures. So rangeland, pasture, and both marginal and non-arable land are out there, and they're necessary. Also, they can convert crop byproducts. That's something I've never really got my head around, is why, when the prices of soybeans and corn go so high, people keep feeding it. There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of byproducts. Maybe they're all cornered and under in trust or something, I don't know. But there are a lot of alternatives. And growing up in Northern California, there were feedlots there that didn't feed any grain. And of course, I moved here in 94. Nobody fed any soybean to anything but a chicken. And that was brought in because they don't grow soybeans in California, not large scale. So there could be a lot more of that as well. So animals are going to be critical to the delivery of nutrients to human population, even if you don't eat them or eat their eggs. Sometimes in these systems, eating the animal is the least imaginative and useful thing that you can do, because they have all these other services involving receiving and delivering nutrients to the soil. There's another issue that I think is important, especially with respect to animals, especially in this country, and that is a disaggregation of the nutrient cycles. That's where there's a geographical separation of nutrient sources and where the nutrients end up. California, dairy operations buy massive quantities of alfalfa hay from the Imperial Valley, hundreds and hundreds of miles north, feed it to the animals. Are they taking the manure back to the Imperial Valley? No, they're not. So then they have a surplus there to deal with. We do it here too. We have a lot of dairy farmers that just grow corn. They call it forage. you know, I guess it is a forage if you make it in silage, but and all of their other feeds are purchased. They may not grow anything else. And if you have a significant number of animals and you don't have enough land to reincorporate those nutrients and then use those, you know, you can have fudge factors, you can have allowable efficiency margins and everything else. But no matter how you do the math, slice it or dice it, you're piling a lot of nutrients into a small area, partially because of disaggregation. So you get a net transfer of nutrients and accumulation of nutrients or pollution problems. I've also seen this go the other way. People dependent upon importing nutrients can get in a bind. When I first came here, 94, 95, somewhere in there, I went to visit a farm because they wanted me to go out and look for poison plants because, or, you know, they're a bunch of cattle from the farm had shown up at the vet school with bottle jaw, which is edema of the jaw. It's usually an indication of a protein deficiency, although you're taught to memorize in vet school that it's also an indication of parasitism that's taken away the protein and albumin and so on. And so they thought that was that. So I said, well, maybe it's a poison. So I went on every inch of it. I found no poisonous plants, which is weird because there's tons of poisonous plants everywhere. But the other thing I didn't find was anything on the farm, no hay, no forage, no silage, no nothing that had more than about 9 or 10% crude protein. And these were big Holsteins being milked like crazy. And I go, well, going to get some cottonseed meal because I just came from California, or soybean meal because I was starting to learn. They go, no, our suppliers ran out. They ran out of soybeans in the United States, are you crazy? No, we're organic. And at that time, the rules on organic changed quite a bit. At that time, he would have had to just given up the premium entirely if he were to bring in non-organic material. It's going, huh. So sometimes you can get a nutrient deficit with mismanage as well. It's not just excess and pollution. One of the interesting papers in this was written in 2005. It was published in Science that looked at disaggregation on a large scale. Brazil was starting to produce a lot of soybeans. Somebody solved the aluminum problem, and they were just exporting tons to China. Now, what did they do with that nitrogen? I mean, there's some parts of China that use too much nitrogen as fertilizer, and together with this, there was no way to make that round trip. My one soil science experiment, I got to talk about it because it's the only thing I did. And I use the science, the term science, loosely. When I was at UC Davis, I had a student want to do an undergraduate project, and looking at the impact of farming on lands. Okay. And so we found a field that had been in sugar beets for years and years and years, and it was divided into three parts in 1956. One part was a crop field, it wasn't fenced, they just grew crops in it. Another part was a pasture. There was a small, the small sheep facility nearby, and they would pasture the sheep there, all irrigated, of course. And then in between was a laneway. It was a little bit raised, but it was from the original soil. It was capped with decomposed granite and sealed pretty well. And so we go, oh my gosh. So we've got three treatments. We have a permanent pasture that's been continuously used for 37 years. We have a field that's been cropped for 37 years. And we have a control. We can drill soil tube down through here and we can find out what was there. And it shouldn't have changed much in all of those years. So that's what we did. We found out how it was managed. There was no manure spread on this land the entire time. Now the department had a manure spreader. They had never put manure in it. They used it as a wagon to carry things around, or they'd paint it green and they'd have it in the picnic day parade, which is a big deal. But they never used it because manure is yucky. It has seeds in it. You could get weeds. It just you don't do that. Well, what were they doing with the manure for 37 years? This really blew my mind. And I'd been there for a while and. My grandfather went there. I mean, I knew the area. They were taking all the manure from the animal units and burying it in the landfill over gravel next to Pewter Creek. Now, to me, that wasn't real good nutrient management, but I'd only taken the one soil science class. So what we did, and we also found that for the field, there was actually records of every crop, how much was harvested, what its nutrient composition was, everything, in sort of the archives in the department. We go, oh boy, we can do this two ways. We can measure what's left relative to the laneway, and then we can estimate how many tons they took out. Occasionally they put nitrogen on it, inorganic nitrogen, to help them plant and stuff. So we went out there and took soil samples at three depths, 21 sites, all these beginner soil science things. And we found that from the crop field over the years, this was a control, the amount of calcium in there had gone down, the amount of magnesium had gone down, phosphorus has gone down. This is per 1,000 grams or per liter. If you're used to per 100, then it's going to look weird. Still not too high. The pasture, on the other hand, maintained most of their calcium, some of their magnesium, and pretty much all of their phosphorus. This was all irrigated. These were all sandy loams. So potassium wasn't hanging around for anybody. It was that just happens. If you did it on the basis of what they were taken out, these are metric tons from a 7-hectare field. This is what they'd exported over that 37 years. This is what I mean by disaggregation. When we buy nutrients from the Midwest and bring it here, not only do they carry the greenhouse gas burden of their production there with inorganic Haber process nitrogen made from natural gas with attendant losses of methane and CO2 and all of the burden from transport. Not only does it have all of that, between those fertilizers, feed brought in, and such, we end up with a situation where we have too much nutrients on the land. Now, integrated systems, a little less aggregation. If animals are fed feeds that are grown right near them, where they're used feed and bedding, as we call manure, are efficiently incorporated into the soil, that's good. Some soil and feed supplements will probably need to be imported. We have chronic and just outstanding micronutrient deficiencies here in New York, especially up along the ridges. But you don't have to bring in much more than you put out. Yeah, there's inefficiencies we'll talk about in a second, but they're not too much. Systems often include grazing, which is the ultimate. Very low fossil fuel content. The animals pick up the feed, they distribute nutrients. Yep, there's some nitrogen loss of volatilization. But most of the carbon loss tends to be the CO2, not so much the methane. And these are things you can do. And there's New York dairy farms that do that. With high disaggregation, you have a large number of animals that are fed entirely on purchased feed. Think of a chicken house. From sources that are way too far away for incorporation of manure or nutrients back in the soil. The holdings that they have, the land may or may not be inadequate to cycle it back, but then where does the nutrients come with the crop that comes up? Is it going into the chickens? Is it going someplace else? And so you end up doing things like shipping soybeans and other feeds across continents and across oceans. The panhandle southeastern swine feeding operations in the Texas and Oklahoma panhandles are growing a lot of that stuff nearby. That's being imported in. They may spread it on the land, but most of it's going in the air or over the water. Southeast happens as well. Poultry operations, and we mentioned processing plants. And there's a lot of dairy farms that do this. They lament that they don't have enough land to score a decent nutrient balance. Another interpretation of that that's less popular in my department is, maybe you have too many animals. That doesn't go over big at meetings. So how did this happen? One is that we've promoted purchase ingredients a lot for animals to put the burdens on the soil. I mean, way back when says, be modern. Feed formula feeds. Don't keep trying to do it yourself. And this has become a a big deal as well. And yeah, if you're looking at the confinement feeding, being able to formulate, modify and formulate feeds to minimize the amount of surplus nitrogen going through the animals makes a lot of sense, if that's what you're doing. And some of them, they get it. They can actually get it. The Sunnyside up here, they invested heavily to make sure that they were containing that, but it's too easy. Stuff happens, and you will do that. Also, we've lost, we have price differentials. Very often, homegrown feeds, in terms of your time and the money and the investment and equipment and all of this, may be more expensive than stuff that's trucked in out of Ohio or Iowa. To you, the price, not the cost to the whole system, but the price. Although sometimes that's reversed. If you have an organic farm and you're getting, you know, $42 per hundred weight rather than whatever the heck it is now, 18 for conventional, you want to either grow your stuff organically or purchase it. And for most organic farmers, the supply of organic feeds can be unreliable. And so they can grow the feeds, and it may cost them more to grow their own feeds than if they bought it from Cargill or something like that. It may cost them more to grow those feeds than if they were growing conventional feeds, but not that much more. So the farmers that still have the skills to grow a lot of these concentrate feeds and so on, they can use those, and their input is cheaper than trying to go out on the market and buy organically grown stuff from somebody else. So I have a lot of problems with organic thing. One is they're not really explicit about nutrient balance on the farms. But accidentally, through this, the nutrient balance in organic farms tends to be closer to zero than it is on conventional ones. Not for anything to do with organic itself, but the fact that, well, heck, they can grow their feeds cheaper than what they can buy, which is kind of the reverse situation for a lot of conventional farmers. Okay, I've taken a lot more time than I thought I was with my few ideas here. Some things we can do is co-locate more. That would help the soil sciences are trying to help the farmers sort out what they're doing to the soil. Use more sustainable sources of organic inputs. And by organic, I don't mean organic in the legal sense. I mean things with carbon-carbon-carbon-hydrogen bond type of inputs. We may be stuck bringing in selenium and cobalt and a few things in this area, but that's not a big deal, in my opinion. And grazing can be more prominent. This state and many states have a lot more grazing capabilities than we're using. At one time or another, about 61% of the dry land surface in the U.S. has been grazed or browsed. A lot of it's pretty thin soup, out there in the desert and so on, but it's used. And others isn't. Others are the edges of very productive fields here, or maybe the hillside above it, which you can put all the fertilizer, everything you want. Your yields and that won't be that great, and they're more erodible soils. Whereas you can sustain that. There's pastoral systems. There's all sorts of systems. Grazing, as I teach a section in grazing, I would love to teach a grazing range management, pasture management class. I don't think one exists. That would be my dream. But the thing about grazing is potentially the most sustainable of all food systems, more sustainable than any cropping system you can imagine. And potentially, it is the least sustainable of all food systems. And some of the moonscapes that you see in the Aegean Sea, some of the islands there in Greece, you can see that. You can see it in different parts of the world, some of the upper slopes in Haiti, this sort of thing. Yeah, you can screw that up. Like so much in production systems, it's how you do it is more important than what you're trying to do. And so when I say historical record indicates mixed success, that is really an understatement. We have destroyed a lot of our food producing capability in this world by not doing grazing correctly. We're running low on time. I want some time for questions, or not questions, if you can straighten me out where I've screwed up here. I'd appreciate that, because I'm going to try to teach this to my class in a couple weeks. So.
Questions? Ideas?
Yeah.
Quite a few years ago, we developed a computer program to calculate the value of forages based on their nutrient
Oh gosh, yeah.
Year after year, the cheapest way to get nutrients on their farm is to buy it rather than grow it. Until the prices of the commodities skyrocketed, that was true. No matter, it didn't have to be organic. It didn't matter which farm it was. It was cheaper to buy your protein and energy.
And and now a lot of our farmers, young and not so young, don't remember the skills to grow the other. I meant to bring this up. I've got tons more slides than I need. This is from Morrison's Feeds and Feeding, 1948, written by the character they named our building after, Morrison Hall. And what they, and there was, we talked about this sense of nutrient management that it was just, intuitive in farmers at that time. And also they put it in dollars. So just like you said with your computer program, he had tables where depending upon what concentrates, refuges, animal products you got, they would, and this is $1948, so I don't know what it means, but the when you went and bought the feed, you know, we think about, okay, it's going to meet the nutrient requirements. Those farmers also thought exactly how much fertilizer am I purchasing if I import feed to my farm? And so they would, there were tables to calculate that, which I guess is like you guys did. And then they calculated the fertility value per ton. And sometimes the fertility value was pretty substantial per ton purchased. And that was fertility, again, in the environment where farming, there weren't as many inputs available as there are now. Yeah?
I've got a meeting across campus. You made my day when you told me you took soil from Connie Gallery.
Yeah.
The scariest course they were having.
The general. We call him the general. I think he'd been a general in the National Guard or something. I don't know. He just did the labs when I took it, so we were lucky. One other story in terms of nutrient management in animals. You've probably read this if you know the local history, but Ithaca area in general, Danby in particular, was a place where a lot of escaped slaves ran to, or walked or rolled or however they got here, into this region. And one of them took up farming in Danby, near where my house is, and he I don't know where he learned to practice or if he invented it or what, but by that point, late 1850s, the trace mineral micronutrient content of the soils had been pretty well beat up out of this area. They had they'd cleared the trees, so they weren't getting that pump of nutrients coming up anymore, and they were depleting that. They had burned all of the oaks for the potash and shipped it out on the Erie Canal because potassium was a very valuable thing. And they actually burned it not just to clear the land, but to have this valuable soil amendment that they could package and send off to the rest of New York. And so people were having trouble with yields. But he had the practice that somewhere he got it, where he would go and pick up every dead animal everywhere in the county that he could get on his wagon. He would take it back, he'd render it with lye, like the vet school does when they digest all of our dead animals in hydroxide. Did the same thing. Then he took that and he put it on the land. It corrected the pH and it brought micronutrients and nitrogen and other things on the land. And his crops were much better than his neighbors, and he was actually had a more sustainable system. So even dead, you know, animals can help the soil be productive. And I don't know if people do that anymore, but he did, and it worked.
Yeah, Peter?
Thanks very much. Lots to think about. When you mentioned sort of losing skills for growing crops, can you say something about losing skills for grazing? I mean, grazing is a complicated system. You're managing mixtures of plants in place, changing over time, et cetera.
Oh no, there's a whole one. If I got into the grazing thing, not only do people need to change that. I mean, animal nutritionists are scared of it. Here you have a feed resource that changes every day. It changes depending on how much they use. Silos don't do that to you.
Right.
You know, it's tricky. On the other hand, it can be very rewarding. Also, the animals need to learn. The animals, that is a learning curve. Sometimes in their adult life, they don't get it. They tend to eat as they were eating when they were 6 to 8 months of age, and you know, that's the way we raise calves. That's more conducive to TMR feed and that sort of thing. But the animals need to learn to graze. The people need to learn to do the grazing. And so there is a learning curve. And our wetware infrastructure for animal nutrition needs to get their head around some of these things. I mean, a lot of universities have range management, pasture management things, and they have that. Maybe it's here too in natural resources and stuff, but I haven't run across it. That's why I'd love to do a grazing class. But. Yeah?
So thanks again for the presentation. So if this disaggregation and this decoupled nutrient cycles are the problem, what is the solution and how do we get there?
I think it's a problem. I don't know. Part of it is the cost, as people have pointed out, of doing it disaggregated for the person who actually makes a decision. Do I want to grow fava beans for a winter crop, or do I want to just buy some cottonseed meal? That's a California question, I guess. But the people making the decision, just like you said, it depends upon the price. And certainly up until recently, they were such, you know, direct subsidies for growing certain crops. There wasn't really a big pasture subsidy. And so there's that, plus, you know, promotion that by, you know, there isn't a lot of, profit margin available to companies who sell inputs if you've gone and you've really learned how to do a pasture. It's going to reduce the soil amendments you buy, it's going to reduce the concentrate feeds that you buy, it's going to reduce a lot of other things. And so they have not been too happy about that, and they've funded white papers from people to say, oh, you know, pasture, it's terrible, it's environmentally, you know, it'd be better off doing confinement feeding. And you know, I've read some of these, kind of like, wait. But the, so there is that. But what we can do, as we said in one slide, is to, you know, look at the farm, look at the land somebody owns. That's what they used to do. Says, okay, how can I make some money off of this? How can I make it so I can keep doing it for generations? And instead of, you know, a lot of people have just been panicked into being essentially feeding stations for feed companies, where you buy in the stuff and you feed it to your animals, your chickens, your pigs, your, you know, whatever it is, and sell it. And they may not even ever have had the land base they needed to produce the feed or to be able to incorporate what goes back. A lot of them are trying it. This state is so much better than other states on this. It's unbelievable. I don't mean to infer, because they had a little accident up the lake, that we're a bunch of screwballs in New York. We're not. Those people are busting their financial metaphorical derrieres trying to manage these nutrients right, and you know they had a breakdown. There are states that are much worse. If you're familiar with the Chesapeake Bay or the Chesapeake Watershed Authority, where they're trying to control the amount of sediments and nutrients going down, Pennsylvania and Maryland shed a lot more nutrients than we do. As a matter of fact, they depend on our clean water coming from our forests and farms into the Susquehanna to go down in the Delaware and go down and rinse out the rest of the watershed. And so there was an early recognition of these issues because in Delaware County and other places there were watersheds for New York City. They used surface water without treatment. And they started fiddling with that years and years ago. And so when it became more important generally, New York was way ahead of everybody. They had in place, not that everybody does it. I remember driving by a farm, you know, for a while there was a subsidy for fencing to fence off riparian habitats along the creek. And on one side of the road was one farm, and they'd fenced off the riparian habitat, and they had a pipe going from the creek to a water trough that was out in the animal field, so they didn't have to go down to the creek to get it. The other person built the same fence, then used it to confine the animals in the riparian habitat. It was just a moonscape, you know, just like. So, you know, a lot of this depends on how you go about it, even with the same policies. But to answer your question, I think more co-location and more integration, and get both sides of controversy here thinking about, oh, I don't have enough land. Oh, maybe I have too many animals. If you can think both sides of that and make adjustments there, I think you won't make the problem easy, but you make the problem simpler. And a lot of policies, including federal policies, have run against this. When I was here in the 70s as a grad student, farmers were able to buy phosphate. I don't know if they got it free or they got it so subsidized because USDA, well, we need phosphorus is good and we need it to support legumes. And so they had this tremendous subsidy for phosphates for everybody. And it was, you know, it's cheap, it's free, I get a little response, and so people just buy it, put it on. We're still draining the phosphorus off of those lands that probably didn't need to be put there in there. And that was seemed like a good policy on some level, but didn't work. So we can, I think co-location would be a good start and improving grazing. I mean, I'm not a grazing fanatic. I mean, it can be done well, it can be done wrong. But we could also establish policies that make it worse, like the phosphate subsidy wasn't too bright. Maybe some places in the country it was, but farms long abandoned, they're gone back to forest and brush over in Tompkins-Schuyler County over here. They're still draining. They've still got a lot of phosphorus there because it seemed like a good idea at the time.
Great, I think we've run out of time. Let's thank Dan for his presentation.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.